Good morning, Hope Church. As we sing and worship this morning, I encourage you to stand with us or pray however you feel fit and join us as we sing these worship songs today. We'll sing Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name.
Let's sing The Sun Comes Up.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Sing it again, bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 years and then forevermore.
Let's sing Bless the Lord to Him.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name.
Sing with me on that day.
When my strength is failing, the end draws near, and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore.
So bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy.
Let's sing that again. Bless the Lord. Here we go.
So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy.
Thank you.
declare who you are. I'm so unworthy, but still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of how great you are.
Sing beautiful and free.
Beautiful and free, the song of galaxies, reaching far beyond the Milky Way. Let's join in with the sound. Come on, let's sing it out as the music of the universe plays. We're singing, you are holy, great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. And I'm so unworthy, but still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of how great. All glory, honor, power is yours. Great and mighty, the moon and the stars declare who you are. And I'm so unworthy, but still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of you.
He is jealous for me, love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When no love is sudden, I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory. And I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane, I am a tree, bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions, eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so. Yes, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves. Yes, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves. We are his portion and he is our prize, drawn to redemption by the grace in his eyes. It's his grace, his ocean, we're all sinking. So heaven meets earth like an unforeseen kiss, and my heart turns violently inside of my chest. I don't have time to maintain these regrets when I think about
today. As a family, we gather to worship, to praise, to be together as we remember the life that was given, because it was the greatest way our God could show us his love for us. Jesus was sent to the cross knowing he would die, and he chose to give his life for us, for you. If you did not get a chance to grab communion when you came in, please raise your hand and ushers will bring it to you. Feel free at any time during the song to take communion, to sing, to kneel, to pray. Feel free at any point in the song to use how you worship to worship your God. As we take this moment to worship, to remember Jesus' sacrifice, know that it is a gift that can never be taken from you, because there is nothing that you did to deserve this. God gave it freely to you, and God wants you to show gratitude for this gift and to live your life to the fullest because of this gift. There is nothing that you can do to have it taken away. And today, as we sing this song, as we worship this song, and as we pray, We remember the hero that was given. We remember the life that was taken. We remember Jesus. He walked the dirty streets, famous for nothing. He said, come follow me naked. A face like all the rest, but something was different. The Son of God would lead the way. And soon they all would say, there he goes, a hero, a savior to the world. Here he stands with scars in his hands. With love he gave his life so we could be free. The Savior of the world. He spoke with clarity. He walked across the sea. A single word would calm the storm. His touch could heal the sick. But he was called a hypocrite, laid behind the stone. His death was shortly mourned. He left the curtain torn. And there he goes, the hero, the savior to the world. Here he stands with scars in his hands. With love he gave his life so we could be free. The Savior of the world. He chose to take the cross, shed tears for the lost, the broken and the needy, forgiving those who were and will be. The angel made it clear. He told them, have no fear. He's not here. He's not here. And there he goes, the hero, the savior to the world. Here he stands with scars in his hands. With love he gave his life so we could be free. The Savior of the world. The Savior of the world. The Savior of the world.
Hey, Hope Church, you glad to be here today? Amen. Let's give it up for Hope Rising. Thank you, gang. I want to thank our artists up here leading us in worship, our tech team, and our Sunday crew. My coworker, Gina Darby, our worship leader and organizer with our ministries, is off today. She and Donald, though, are in our midst. I actually planned to brag on them. It's in my notes, and just so I could see if she listened to the recording or not. No, I'm just kidding. But, you know, I was thinking, she hadn't taken a day off for a long time, and I owe her a lot. You know, the 25, 26 weeks broadcasting from my house was kind of nice to take a shower and walk down the hall and preach in my shorts and no shoes on, you know. I know that's a bad visual, but and my dog was my congregation. It was kind of cool, you know, but then to still connect with you all online, and then Gina and the team here working hard. And so I'm really thankful to my dream team and my coworkers. And my heart goes out to Donald, who's also been a great servant working. His stepdad, Bill, passed from this life. And so I want to be in prayer for the Darby family, for Sandy. Bill was a very charismatic, influential guy in the family and did a lot of good things for people. And it's just a tough time right now. And so we want to keep them in prayer. I'm also feeling so many emotions. So excited to see Crystal and Courtney and Sophie here, three generations from the Salcedo family. And Crystal's part of some of our people that migrated up to Idaho, and we miss them all so much, and they're making a good life up there. And some of them are part of our broadcast, which is really cool. And at the same time, I'm sad. I just saw Vicky in our online church, who was tested positive with COVID and is feeling awful. And so I've got so many emotions going. Vicki, we want to pray for you, and Don, we want to pray for your family. And I also wanted to thank Donald and Randy and Cal, if you worked, and Tom, whoever else helped out for our sound panels, which are going to already making a big difference, and they're going to be installed, and they're making our room sound a lot better. And that takes time and work, and just thank everybody that's involved in that. I'd like to say a prayer before I jump into this message. Father, I feel so many emotions now with so many people dealing with so many things. And I pray especially for Vicky, for her healing. You are the great physician. You can do what man can. I pray for you to guide those who work with her. I pray for her to feel good and for her to be healed, God, and for you to be glorified. I pray for others that are dealing with COVID. I thank you that my son and daughter-in-law have now been through it and didn't have bad symptoms and are doing well. And pray for my other kids that were possibly exposed. I pray for all of us who have friends and family that may have been or are. We pray for Phyllis to continue to heal and cover. And Father, we pray that you will touch the Darby family as they go through this challenging time also. And the loss of a loved one, and just pray for your spirit to move among them. God, help me in this message now, because I believe it's so important for all our lives, because you had it written and taught for us to be a part of all of our lives. And we pray in Jesus' name, amen. I want to thank everybody to have you in our service here at the Ridge, here inside, distanced out, and to have people outside sitting and to have even drive-up worship is really cool here, to have options on the Ridge. And then those of you on our online church are such an encouragement. Every week when I go home, I sit and read all the comments, and I praise God, and I thank you all for the constant encouragement. Two locations, online and on the Ridge, one church. That's hope. And so today, I wanted to continue with the subject I talked about last week. You remember last week I talked about, I thank my God for you, and talked about being thankful, and I pray you had a good Thanksgiving. And you know, we had planned to have some more of our kids show, but then some of them were potentially exposed, and Zach and Kate, who I was just praying about, just tested positive but have gotten through it and are doing well, didn't have bad symptoms. They're in Minnesota, but then a couple from San Jose were potentially exposed, so they didn't want to come and be around Grandpa and Grandma, and our greats weren't able to make it either. And so, like you, you know, we're all touched by this thing in a lot of different ways, but I pray you still had a good Thanksgiving, and I did. And one of the things I don't like is to have a day called a holiday, and okay, let's be thankful, and then we forget all about it after we overeat or whatever, you know, and move on to the next subject, because I believe an attitude of gratitude is something that God calls all of us to experience and to live out, and he even promises to help us with. It's an important characteristic. It's very easy to focus on negative things. And I believe some of us are more naturally focused on positive, and some can gravitate more naturally to negative based on our background, our upbringing, different voices in our life, we can gravitate to one or the other. In fact, there was a positive guy who had a negative friend, and he wanted to try to cheer him up, so he drove over to his house, and he goes, "Hey, why don't we go duck hunting tomorrow?" And the negative friend said, "Well, it'll probably rain, but I'll go." And so the next day, it was a beautiful day, and the positive guy pulls up in front of his house and says, "See, it's a beautiful day." And the negative guy gets in his truck, and he goes, "Yeah, but we probably won't see any ducks." So they drive out to this place where they go alongside this marsh, and pretty soon, sure enough, there's some ducks off in the distance. And the positive guy, "See, there's some ducks." And the negative goes, "Yeah, but they probably won't fly close enough for us to shoot." But the positive guy is right. They actually fly overhead, and they both unload their guns. Kaboom! And a duck falls right in front of them, right in the middle of a pond. And the negative guy says, "Should have known it would land in the water." And the positive guy says, "Don't worry about that. Watch this. Rover!" And his dog comes up and he says, "Fetch!" And Rover walks out on top of the water, picks the duck up, walks back on top of the water, and placed it at his master's feet. And the positive guy goes, "Well, what do you think of that?" And the negative guy says, "Your old dog can't swim, can he?" And there are some who can constantly gravitate to one or the other. But the truth is that God calls us to be grateful people. And there is power in gratitude. It's actually seen as a cool thing, I believe, and some in our culture, increasingly so, to be cynical and sarcastic and negative and critical. Like you get a reward or something for critiquing all the time. And there's good constructive criticism, of course. I'm not talking about that. But cutting down all the time. And God calls us to be a people of gratitude. There are actually benefits that the world, the human beings, are seeing and studying. There are people who have careers studying things like the impact that gratitude has on your life. I read one article that talked about 7 scientifically proven benefits of gratitude that will motivate you to give thanks year-round. It was written by a woman, Amy Morin, who is a psychotherapist and an international best-selling author. And she writes about how being thankful on Thanksgiving is nice, but something we should continue year-round, and that being thankful throughout the year could have tremendous benefits on your quality of life. And she says it's an overlooked tool that we all have access to and can be cultivated without any cost financially and not a whole lot of time. And so she talks about 7 benefits from people who have gratitude from scientific research. The first one, she says, gratitude opens the door to more relationships. It just talks about simple things like manners and saying thank you and open the door, and how showing gratitude with relationships can develop friendships, can develop potential opportunities at work and success at work. And just a simple thing by an attitude of gratitude. Secondly, gratitude improves physical health. They found in research that people that have gratitude experience fewer aches and pains and report feeling healthier than other people. They exercise more, they take better care of themselves, and get regular checkups, which is more likely to attribute to their longevity. She said, 3, gratitude improves psychological health. Gratitude reduces a multitude of toxic emotions, ranging from envy and resentment to frustration and regret. Robert A. Emmons, PhD, has conducted multiple studies on the link between gratitude and well-being, and his research confirms that gratitude effectively increases happiness and reduces depression. 4, gratitude enhances empathy and reduces aggression. Grateful people are more likely to have a more positive social manner, and even when others are less kind, people with gratitude, according to a study in 2012 by the University of Kentucky, that study says that people are less likely to retaliate against others. When given negative feedback, they handle it better. They have more sensitivity and empathy toward people, and a decreased desire to seek revenge. Number five, grateful people actually sleep better. One study published in Applied Psychology, Health and Well-Being, suggested that if you're having trouble sleeping, to journal like 15 minutes, writing down things you're grateful for. And they claim that it's proven that people will sleep better and sleep longer. Number six, gratitude improves self-esteem. A 2014 study published in the Journal of Applied Sport Psychology found that gratitude increased athletes' self-esteem, which helped them perform at higher levels. Other studies have shown that gratitude reduces social comparisons. Rather than becoming resentful toward people who have more money or better jobs, which is a major factor in a reduced self-esteem, grateful people are able to appreciate other people's accomplishment. And number seven, gratitude increases mental strength. For years, research has shown that gratitude not only reduces stress, but it may also play a major role in overcoming trauma. One study showed that gratitude helped war veterans to have lower levels of PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. Another study showed that gratitude was a major contributor to resilience with people following the terrorist attacks and 9/11. Recognizing all you have to be thankful for, even during the worst of times in your life, can foster resilience, she writes. And then Morin concludes, we all have the ability and opportunity to cultivate gratitude. Simply take a few moments to focus on all that you have rather than complaining about all the things you think you deserve. Developing an attitude of gratitude is one of the simplest ways to improve your satisfaction with life. What's the point? Why am I reading all this secular thought and research of bright minds about how gratitude benefits our mental and physical health and our quality of life? Because I want you to listen to something that was written 2,000 years ago from 1 Thessalonians 5:16 through 18. Paul, who wrote the letter to the Philippians that we studied last week, Paul writes to another church that he had preached at in Thessalonica. He says, verse 16, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. I think it's so cool that bright people are even having careers in great places studying a subject that God says, I want you to have this in your life, because God knows what's good for us. God taught it a long time ago about being grateful and the importance of gratitude. Last week, the letter that we looked at, Paul wrote from, anybody remember? Okay, where were you guys last week? No, I'm just kidding. He wrote from prison. He wrote from Rome. And that was a little bit later in his life. This is an earlier letter after his missionary journey where he had gone through and he had taught there. It's just around 51 or 52 AD. He preached in Thessalonica on his second missionary journey, and then he had left, and he sent Timothy and some other workers that he worked with to go back and check on them and see how you're doing, because they'd gone through a lot of hard times, persecution, and there was riots and all kinds of crazy stuff that happened and before Paul left. But the church was started, and started well, even though they went through difficulty. And they had Jews and Gentiles, two different, very different cultures that before had not been together, now becoming part and one in the body of Christ through the gospel that has no religious or racial barriers where people can't come to Jesus. Everyone can come to God through Jesus Christ, and everyone is welcome and accepted. It's not segregated with Jesus. And so these Jews and Gentiles were learning to become one family. And Greeks at that time period had idolatry. The Jews in other periods had struggled with it, but it was a big time influence on the culture of the early church. and the Gentiles. And so they had been serving these, worshiping these idols, and then they're turning from those idols to come to Christ. And Paul heard a good report from Timothy when he came back. So this letter of 1 Thessalonians is really, it's Paul writing them saying how thankful he is and encouraging them, these young believers, to grow. And so what we want to do, remember, context is king in interpreting or even appreciating Scripture. So to get the full benefit of that theme verse I just read a moment ago, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus, it's better to know the background. So we want to look at the context and the text before we look at our task. And in the very first chapter, Paul says in verse 2, we always thank God for you and continually mention you in our prayers. God does something to us relationally when we work together in the ministry. And he says, we remember before our God and Father your work produced by faith, your labor prompted by love, and your endurance inspired by hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. You see in those verses three key words, three key ingredients to have a successful church and to have a successful Christian life: faith, love, and hope. Faith in Christ. Love is the motive of their labor. He says they're not working out of a guilt trip. They're not working to be noticed by others. They're serving, they're laboring out of love. And their hope is in the future. Their hope is that even though they're going through hard times and sufferings, one day, Jesus is going to return to take all believers home to be with him. Those who have already died and those who are still alive will go to be with the Lord forever. Paul addresses that theme in this letter, and that's a big part of their endurance and hope, because they look forward to where they're going. It's not all about here and now and what they're dealing with now. And then he says that they had become a model church. In verses 6 through 8, you became imitators of us and of the Lord, for you welcomed the message in the midst of severe suffering with the joy given by the Holy Spirit. And so you became a model to all believers in Macedonia and Achaia. The Lord's message rang out from you not only in Macedonia and Achaia. Your faith in God has become known everywhere. Therefore, we do not need to say anything about it. I think it's so awesome that this church that had gone through great difficulty and had faith and love and hope became a church that people were talking about everywhere. There's nothing wrong with wanting to be a model church if your desire is to bring glory to God. If your work is from faith in Christ, not religion and behaviorism, hey, look how awesome I am. If your labor is not, oh, I guess I got to do this, I don't want to go to hell, or I want to make everybody happy, so I guess I do. But if your labor is out of love, I just love to serve God. I love to serve people. I love to love God, love people over and over to be poured out. If your desire is hope, as you're looking forward, the world is not all about here and now. This is temporary. But we're looking forward that one day we're going to be with the Lord forever and ever. We're going to be with God's forever family. And so we have hope even though we're going through difficult times. And you become a model church. There's not a thing wrong with that. The greatness of a church is not its seating capacity. It's its sending capacity. We are a sent people. I'm not talking about our smell. Our women have a better scent than us guys. But I'm talking about the fact that as a follower of Jesus, we all are sent. Every week when we go out, after we gather, we're a sent people to go out with hope and joy and love and loving God and loving people and serving. And we all share Jesus in different ways. God didn't make you the way you are so you can try to be like somebody else. You're to be who you are. We're not into cookie cutter disciples around here. Be who God made you to be to His glory. And we are sent out. And that's what makes a church great, when they're ringing out the message of Jesus. Endurance through difficulty is something we see. Paul continues on what Timothy and those who checked on the church reported him. He writes in verse 9 and 10, "They tell how you turn to God from idols to serve the living and true God, and to wait for a Son from heaven, whom He raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the coming wrath." The Greek culture that were a part of the church turned from serving dead idols. For some reason, we human beings are tempted to worship the work of our own hands. That can be in idols we call God that we create, that we bow down to, like you've seen certain little constructed statues or things that people in different cultures will bow down and build an altar to. But it could also be things we do and make with our giftedness that God has given us instead of worshiping the gifter. Every year, this time, my kids tease me because I become Clark Griswold. Some of you know who that is. That's from the movie, the Christmas Vacation movie. And Clark in National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation movie gets a little goofy on tearing up lights everywhere and causing blackouts. And I always have, whether we're in an apartment or renting or when we were able to get a home, a nice home, I'm always gone crazy on the decorations. And it's fun. And I get done and I like to look at the lights and I like to look at the trees and I like to go, wow. But I'm not worshiping it. The reason for the season is Jesus. That's who we worship. Amen? And that's why it's a fun season. And it's also an opportunity for us to be light to our neighborhoods. And Paul says that they had turned to serve the living God. Our God is a living God. He's not dead wood or dead things created by man, by human beings. He's a living God. And he says, "And you have turned to wait for His Son from heaven, whom He raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the coming wrath." Jesus overcame the death on the cross. And he's saying, just as He overcame death, He's going to come back and get us and take us to the Father's house. In 1 Thessalonians 4, he said, he talks about those who are still alive and those who are dead, they will be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air, and so will be with the Lord forever. And then he says, therefore, encourage one another with these words. We have encouragement because of the hope that we have. In the context of the chapter, he says, we don't grieve like those who have no hope. We have a hope. Yes, we grieve, but we can have a spring in our eye, a sparkle in our eye, and a spring in our step because we have hope in Jesus Christ, hope over death. We don't know what the future holds, but we know who holds the future. History is His story. Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. And the teaching from Thessalonians is what Jesus demonstrated to us when He thought things like, I don't even know when the end's going to come. The Father is in charge of that. And basically He said, live every day like it's your last, and one day you'll be right. And He calls us to live that way and not waste time with things that are not living to the full, living to the max. And so that's the text. Now we come back to our verse, our theme verse for today. Rejoice always, pray continually, Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. So here's the task from the text. Number one, and I put the word my on all these points because I want to encourage us all to internalize these points. Number one, my joy cannot be taken away. He says rejoice always. He doesn't say rejoice when things go like you planned them. Rejoice when things go like you want them. Rejoice when things go like you think they ought to go. Rejoice when you don't have any pain or suffering. Rejoice as long as everybody likes you. Rejoice as long as you don't have any difficulty. No, he says, rejoice always. The Greek word in the original Bible, hope, what does always mean? Always. There is a difference between biblical joy and happiness. It's good to be happy, but happiness can come from happenings. Happiness can come from circumstances. Joy is inward. Joy is different. Biblical joy comes from the inside. We read in verse 6, you welcomed the message in chapter 1 in the midst of severe suffering. In the midst of severe suffering with the joy given by the Holy Spirit. Not an external circumstance, an inward thing that the Lord puts in us. This Holy Spirit is God, is part of God, that He lives in us. His Spirit lives in us. When we let Him come into our life and we put our faith in Christ and we become a believer, His Spirit lives in us. Our body is a temple and He gives us joy that cannot be taken away. That's why that we're able to endure any difficulty in this life. That's why even when we suffer disappointment, when we go through struggles and hurts and aches and pains, we still have joy. And I just want to make a point here. I'm not talking about the church lady fake, everything is wonderful Christianity. You know, bless God. Oh, you shouldn't be sad. You're a Christian. Where's your faith? I'm not talking about that. I have a hero up in Brookings who's fighting cancer, and I hate cancer. And I love her. She's part of our online church. And I pray for her, and I want her to keep fighting, and it makes me angry. And there's things in this world that should piss us off. And we shouldn't waltz around acting like we got it all together and everything's wonderful because we're a Christian. No, everything's not wonderful. This is the fallen world, and we have pain and we have suffering like everybody else. But inside, we have a joy that overcomes this world that we look forward to and we endure because our Savior overcame death and we have victory. Amen. You shouldn't feel sad when you're going through difficult. You shouldn't feel bad or guilty if you're feeling sad for what you're dealing with. You have every right to feel what you feel. God made you to have feelings and emotions. And it hurts when people we love suffer, or they get sick, or they die. It hurts when our relationship, someone rejects us. It hurts when we grieve over difficult times, but we don't grieve like those who have no hope. Inside of us, we have a hope that cannot be taken away. My joy cannot be taken away. Number two, my power source is my relationship with my Father in heaven. He says, rejoice always, and he says, pray continually. Sandwiched with rejoice always and being thankful, giving thanks in all circumstances, why in the middle would he say pray always? Because our relationship with God is what helps us to have joy always and what helps us to be able to give thanks in all circumstances and live with gratitude because we walk with God. Because our Father is a good, good daddy who loves us and He has a purpose for us and meaning in our life. We're not a mistake. We may have been called stupid or told we don't amount to nothing, or we made mistakes that we're embarrassed by in our life. We all fall short, and yet God has a purpose and He has meaning in our life. and he cares about us. And when I talk to him as I go through this life, I have the power to rejoice always and to give thanks in all circumstances. I'm not talking about religious, holy mumble jumble talk. The relationship. He wants to have a relationship with. Isn't that amazing that the creator of the universe wants to have a relationship, a personal relationship with you and me? That blows my mind. He's not a God who just created this universe to go, wow, isn't that awesome? But he wants to be involved in our everyday lives. And so Paul says, pray continually. Keep talking to your God. As you go through your day, God, thank you for this and thank you for that. God, I love you. Father, help me with this. God, give me strength. God, help so-and-so, this person I love so much. God, help me to reach this person. And you can enjoy your life with God and pray continually, and God will help you. Remember last week's prayer from Philippians, a mentioning of prayer, where Paul said, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, there's our word for gratitude, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. I know I'm preaching to people who know what that means, to be at the end of your rope and then give it all to God, and all of a sudden he takes it. And there's a peace that's hard to comprehend. It surpasses our comprehension. Number three, I was created to rise above all circumstances. I was created to rise above all circumstances. How do I know that? Because he says, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. He's writing to Christians. He's writing to the church there at Thessalonica, and those letters have been passed down through time to help all Christians. God's will, God's purpose. You weren't an accident. You have a purpose in your life, and one of those things in my life, in your life, is that we display this gratitude, and we rise above all circumstances. They're going through severe suffering with gratitude, and they're bringing glory to God. Viktor Frankl suffered in the Nazi concentration camps, and he became a psychologist after World War II, and he wrote about what it was like. He said, I finally realized there they'd taken all my clothes. They had taken my wedding ring. They took everything. And I realized there was one thing they could not take, and that was my attitude and my hope and my faith. He also wrote that the prisoners who did better in these terrible circumstances were those who maintained some kind of hope. They looked forward to being with their loved ones again. They had something that they kept looking forward to. And that's what Paul's writing about for all of us in Christ, that we look forward to where we're going, that it's not all about here and now. Number four, we see from Paul's writing, my God's got this. He says, this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Those of us who are in Christ Jesus, we're living out God's will for us. So that means COVID, that means disunity in the world, that means anything that we're dealing with, whether it's health, financial, love for concern for loved ones, that we have help. We have a power that's greater than our difficulty. You know, I started when my little kids were little, with four kids, I started an annual turkey bowl when I could on Thanksgiving with my kids. And they always made a big deal of it. You know, even if it's in a little tiny yard, this is the turkey bowl. And so I just built that tradition, and we would play. And now the kids are grown up, and so I started doing it with the grandkids. And then I found out, much to my joy, that there's five of my grandsons now, the older ones that are playing football, and they love football. You know, I never was one of those parents that tried to relive the life he wished he'd have done by getting his kids to like what he liked, you know. But if they did happen, I always told them, I'll be your greatest cheerleader. I don't care if you play chess or whatever, I'll be your greatest cheerleader. But those, some of them are now crazy into football. So I got this field I put together, and it had a football field, and then Allie was supposed to be here with her four boys, and three of them are bigger, and Ryder, Courtney's supposed to be here with Ryder's bigger, and he loves to play. Well, they and I picked them up at the airport, and little Ava gets in the car. She's got her mask on, and little Liam Stanley. For some reason, Liam Stanley likes to eat a lot. You know, my namesake. I don't know what the connection is, but anyway, it was so good seeing them. And Ava says, "I'm going to see my cousins," because they thought that Allie was going to be there with her four. And then Ryder was excited to play football with Jake and Luke and Caleb. Well, turns out Allie's crew couldn't make it. So the kids were disappointed, and we were all sad about that. But Ryder says, "Okay, I got the plan. Gracie has to play. I'll be a quarterback for both sides." And so he made some rules. And so through the week, he played catch with Gracie. Gracie is Grandma Tracy and my wife. And so they played catch. And then, sure enough, the game came on Turkey Day. And Tracy caught a first touchdown, and I was defending her. I was kind of blown away by that. I was like, "You go, girl." So she's now a starter next year, and she's excited about that. So anyway, then I got a pass, and I was in the open, and I was running down the sideline. Now, I haven't run in maybe a couple of years. I don't know. Run as hard as I could. And I was just trying not to fall, run as hard as I could, and I made it, and I scored a touchdown, and Ryder came running in, laughing so hard, and he said, "Papa, you look like you thought you were running really fast, but you weren't moving very fast." And he laughed so hard about that. And you know, the next day I woke up and I felt great until I moved, you know, and I was like, "Oh, everything's hurting." You know, what I'm trying to get at here is we only have so much power on our own. You know, young people, they think they're going to all be strong and fast all their life, you know, and they make fun of older people. And I like to go, "Yeah, your time has come. You just wait, because it goes by faster than you think." I remember people used to say, "It just seems like yesterday." And I'd say, "Yeah, whatever." And now I go, "Wow, it really seems like yesterday." And sooner or later, you're going to come to a time when your power, you need more, a greater power than yourself. And I have good news. It's available to you. God's got you, and God's got this. God's got these circumstances. Doesn't matter who you voted for, didn't vote for. Doesn't matter who wins this or that. God's got you, and God's got this, and He's in charge. But the challenge is for us to give Him ourselves. See, my joy cannot be taken away. I can rejoice always. My power source is my relationship with my Father, and I can rejoice always and pray continually with Him. And then I was created to rise above all my circumstances so I can give thanks always. And this is God's will for me in Christ Jesus. So God's got this. But the challenge is, will I say, "God, I am yours"? Will I say that? "I am yours. I'm yours." That's what we got to do. We got to do it every day when we're beat up in this world. You got to get up and say, "God, I am yours." You got to get up, sit on the side of our bed. "Okay, today, I am yours. I don't feel it good. I feel weak. I need your strength. I need your help. God, I am yours." And God's got you. Let's pray together. Father, I pray especially for anybody that's going through a special challenging time right now. All of us are affected by different things in this fallen world, and we're all human. And I pray for them to feel your strength, to feel your comfort, to feel your love, God. And I pray for anybody that hasn't crossed the line, maybe been trying to tough it on their own, been trying to pull themselves up by their own bootstraps, today to surrender and to say with all of us, "God, I am yours. I am yours." Give yourself to God. Ask Him to make Himself known to you, and He will. Father, we praise You that even though we sometimes feel sad or we get beat up, we have a joy that cannot be taken away. We can overcome all our circumstances because of who our Father is and who we talk to. And You got this. We give it to You in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and worship God.
True, you hold me at Your perfect grace. I saw You too.
Breakfast this next week, Saturday at 8. See Mike about that for any questions, and please sign up. There's a sign-up sheet in the back. I'm so excited about after we have a campaign, like we had our love campaign, when we do community activities. And one of them that we're doing is ringing at the kettles for the Salvation Army, and Joe tells me that all of the time slots are filled up, so that's really cool. We'll have some people from Hope out there sharing the love. Another exciting thing from the Darby group is Angel Tree. Angel Tree is a program put on by the Salvation Army, but it's carried out by partners from the community as well. And what you do, there's a Christmas tree in the back along the wall that you take a tag. The tag has information. The angels represent children from babies to age 13 that come from low income or homeless situations. So it's a precious need, and you can be a real blessing. You get gifts. It'll tell you all the information about that. You bring it back by December 13th or to the Salvation Army. And you have to, when you get the tag, please remember to sign the sign-up sheet so that our leaders know who signed up to be a part of Angel Tree. It's a great cause. I'm thankful that group's doing that. You can see Debbie Larson or Gina Darby if you have any other questions. And I think that's all my commercials. Thanks for being here. Now it's time to pray for our offering. Whoa, that's just, I don't hear it on that. Now it's time to pray for our offering. Yes, yes. Thank you. Let's pray. Father, we want to celebrate giving because you taught us about giving by giving your son. And so we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you that we get to be a force of hope on the ridge and beyond that brings you glory. That's our goal and our greatest aim in life. Please make us continue to be that and that you'll be lifted up. We pray in Jesus' name. Hey, before we give, what is our purpose? Building relationships that last forever. How do we do that? Love God, love people. So remember, every single day this week, in Christ, we always have hope. Thanks for being here.
Free to live, free to give, free to be, I'm free to live.